The primary focus of water utilities is to provide safe and reliable drinking water to its customers. To achieve this, drinking water is subjected to thousands of tests and a variety of treatment processes. Quality reports are provided to customers annually. To ensure the water is safe to drink, water utility companies screen for a variety of contaminants, such as coliform bacteria. While the concern is pathogenic microorganisms, the current day technology does not enable us to measure these pathogens directly. Instead, the water is analyzed for the presence of coliform bacteria. There are about 100 different species of coliforms, known collectively as the total coliform group, many of which live in the intestines of warm-blooded animals. These are called the fecal coliforms, and the most common fecal coliform in the human intestine is E. coli. While the coliforms are generally harmless, their presence in water indicates possible fecal contamination, and thus the possible presence of pathogens. Their absence is strong evidence that fecal contamination is not present and that the water is pathogen-free. Water utilities are required to use any one of the three methods approved by the United States Environmental Protection Agency for detecting the presence of coliforms in drinking water: CollAlert, membrane filtration, and multiple tube fermentation. The multiple tube fermentation is the oldest of these three methods and has been used to determine the safety of water supplies for the past century. In this method, we look for the evidence of gas production in the test tubes. This is because coliforms will produce carbon dioxide gas from sugars, such as laurel tryptose. The multiple tube fermentation analysis has three steps: the presumptive test, the confirmed test, and the completed test. The analysis begins with the presumptive test. Here, a 10 milliliter sample of water is carefully added into a sterilized test tube containing the laurel tryptose broth. If coliforms are present in the sample, they will use this sugar as a food supply and will produce carbon dioxide gas as a waste product. Any gas produced will be trapped within the smaller inverted tube inside the main test tube. Often, this test is performed on multiple tubes, instead of the single one shown here, and sometimes with smaller sample sizes than the 10 milliliters. Once the sample is in place, the test tube is swirled to mix the contents, and then it is placed in an incubator. The incubator is a laboratory device that provides a dark, constant temperature environment. The temperature is 35 degrees Celsius, approximately human body temperature. Together with the supply of food and water, the incubator is an ideal growth environment for the coliform bacteria. In this environment, the bacteria will reproduce at a rate so as to double the population every 20 minutes. This means that a single coliform bacterium could give rise to a population of millions in less than a day. After 48 hours of incubation, the results of the presumptive test are recorded. The test tubes are inspected, looking for gas production. In drinking water samples, the actual production of bubbles should be rare, in less than 5% of samples analyzed. If we see no gas bubble, the test is negative for total coliforms. At this point, our water is considered to be free of pathogens as well, and no further analysis is required. If bubbles are evident, we have a positive presumptive test. In that case, we are required to move to the second step in the multiple tube fermentation analysis, the confirmed test. A sample from each positive presumptive test tube is then transferred into a new test tube containing more sugar and another ingredient, brilliant green bile. While several microorganisms may show up as positive under the conditions of the presumptive test, only the total coliform bacteria will be able to produce carbon dioxide in the presence of the bile. That means the confirmed test is more selective for coliforms than the presumptive test. If no gas bubble is evident after an additional 48 hours of incubation, then the confirmed test is negative. This means that there are no total coliforms, and thus no pathogens, and our analysis is concluded. If a bubble is apparent, then the test is positive for total coliforms. However, remember that fecal coliforms are of greater public health concern than the larger total coliform group, because the fecal group normally is found in the intestines. This means that another test must be performed to determine if our total coliform positive sample also contains fecal coliforms. There are a number of different ways to make this determination, including the EC plus MUG technique. The EC stands for E. coli, and the MUG is a special ingredient that will fluoresce bright blue under an ultraviolet lamp if the most common fecal coliform, E. coli, is present. In this event, the sample is not only positive for total coliforms, but for the more critical fecal coliforms as well. This could lead to what is called an acute violation of the total coliform rule. The third step in the multiple tube fermentation analysis is the completed test. This is rarely conducted on drinking water samples because the presence or absence of total and/or fecal coliforms is all that is needed to determine the safety of our water supply. The completed test uses a number of advanced bacteriological techniques, including microscopic analysis to determine the actual identity of the microorganisms present. For the past 100 years, the multiple tube fermentation analysis has been used to determine, is the water safe to drink? Samples that have negative results for total coliforms in this analysis are free from fecal contamination and thus free from pathogens.